That's your mama's fart hole, Rankin. The bitch is loud.
You're all punks hiding there, yelling in the dark. Let me tell you where you assholes stand. First there's God. Then the warden. Then my guards. Then the dogs out there in the kennel. And finally you. Pieces of human waste. No good to yourselves or anybody else.
This is John P. Wright. He was an Irish-American character actor who made his mark as a performer in movies from the 1970s and into the 1990s. John was known for his crazy intensity, and he was often cast as tough guys and hardcore villains.
What can I say?
There is a level of unhinged madness to his characters that is fascinating to watch. This is some of his work. After serving a few years in the army, John worked as a welfare inspector before going full-time into acting by doing television and small parts in motion pictures. He was also a close friend of Jack Nicholson and appeared in many of his movies, the first one being Five Easy Pieces.
Catherine?
Alive is an interesting 70s horror movie with a terrific score by Bernard Herrmann. John is the unlucky father of a newly born monster baby who escapes from the hospital and wreaks havoc in Los Angeles. It would be one of the few movies in John's career where he played the leading role.
Lock it up. Study it. But let it live, please. Put down your weapons. It's wounded. Can't hurt anybody.
That son of a bitch dies here and now!
Drop it and stand aside, Davis.
1 second whether you're holding it or not. I'm going to put a bullet through it.
Hold your fire now. Don't shoot.
Kill it, Lieutenant. Kill us. Kill us. Kill us now.
By 1975, John was already established as a working actor, with many credits under his belt. He did his third movie with Nicholson, the obscure western Missouri Breaks, which also stars Marlon Brando, who has a weird Irish accent in the movie. In 1978, John returned for the sequel to It's Alive, this time called It Lives Again, which reunites most of the cast members from the first film. It's a pretty forgettable sequel, which starts off good, but doesn't up the stakes of the story, and it lacks the intensity and punch of the first film.
Did you hear me? I said, who's there?
It's not the police. Turn it off. Please.
He reunited again with Nicholson and director Bob Rafelson in the steamy 1981 drama film The Postman Always Rings Twice. In this next scene, he tries to extort Jack for $10,000 and suffers the consequences.
Nice place here.
You want $100?
I want 10 grand.
10 grand? What are you, crazy, bozo? Are you insane? We give the money to cats.
Who cares? I just want the money. Get it for me.
Hey.
Sell the place. Bring me 10 or I mail a confession off the sack and you die at the end.
These are the men who had the right stuff.
They all want to see Buck Rogers, and that's us.
Can't do that, John. It's the vice president, the head of the program. You're going to think of the broader interests of this program.
You are way out of line here.
I'm out of line?
Yes, sir.
I'm running this show here.
We'll see about that.
Yeah? And I'm thinking of changing the order of flight assignments.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
Who are you going to get?
Who am I going to get?
You heard what he said.
That's right.
Just take it easy, fellas,
huh?
Step aside, pal.
Tomorrow is a business day. Clear? Is it clear?
Yeah.
When it's shake hands. Shake fucking hands! In the next room, gentlemen, is the best food, drink, and pussy available at any price in New York. Yeah. I suggest you take a sample of these things and try to remember that this is why we work so hard, to live the way the kings and princes live in this world, eh? Come on, get out of here.
The next year, John would start a partnership with Canon Films, appearing in 4 of their movies. The first one was Runaway Train.
Whatever doesn't kill me makes me stronger.
We'll see. Please, try again. And I'll send you out of here in plastic.
You do what you have to do, and I'll do what I have to do. Whatever happens, happens.
In Runaway Train, John plays an evil prison warden who is after two convicts who has escaped from his maximum security prison and are trapped on an unstoppable train in the Alaskan wilderness. It's easily one of the best films Cannon ever produced and proved to be a career highlight in John's filmography.
I don't give a shit if your whole goddamn prison's on the loose. I got a killer train on my hands with three goddamn people on board and I got no free tracks left to play with.
Right.
So do me a fucking favor and get lost or I'm gonna have your ass kicked out of here. I'm the double! You keep an eye on her. I'm gonna go take a leak.
Do that.
I hope you don't like it and want to do something about it. Yeah, I didn't think you wanted to back up that loud conversation. Wipe that piss off your face. And I won't hear any more crap out of you. If I don't get my convicts back, the prison will be out of control. You know what a riot in a maximum security prison looks like? Your brains are too small to imagine it. Now, where's the train?
Track one.
I'm gonna kick your teeth in. You're playing with me. You tell me real straight, got it? You tell me how to find that train with the helicopter.
Yeah. I'll show you.
New York!
No, gentlemen. It is our constitutional right to bear arms. It is our sacred duty to do so as efficiently as we know how. Become soldiers in the cause of freedom and the American way of life. When these yellow belly liberals call us paranoid and try to hand over our country to the goddamn commies without a fight, we can and we will, with an iron fist, say no!
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 John plays Elliot Glastonbury, the leader of a right-wing paramilitary group called the Pentangle, who hunts and targets people for sport, similar to the most dangerous game. Cannon action star Michael Dudikoff is one of the targets for the hunt.
My. You are an extraordinary young man, Hunter. I do admire you, son.
You leave my sister alone, you son of a bitch. She can't hurt you.
No, you're being invited to participate in the great game. Your sister is our insurance. You'll turn up. We've had our eyes on you for quite a while. There's a fait dodo in Ville de Lovette 2 weeks from today. If you accept our invitation, you'll find your sister there, Virgo Intacto. Should you talk to anyone, well, I'll leave that to your imagination. Good luck. I know about your friend's daughter, Mr. Kersey. I also know that you shot the pusher who sold her the drugs. But I ask you, sir, what about the people behind him? How many children do we let them destroy before we say enough, Mr. Kersey? How many? I've spent a small fortune buying information on the major drug dealers in Los Angeles. I'll give you money, weapons, names, anything you want. They have to be stopped, Kersey.
In Death Wish 4, John plays Nathan White, a mysterious man who hires Bronson to take out several top criminals in the Los Angeles underworld. It is later revealed that he's a rival crime lord who tricks Bronson into doing his dirty work for him by killing off his competition. Naturally, Bronson comes after him.
Stop!
I warned you, I'd kill her! I warned you! I'd kill her!
Sometimes John would switch up and play a good guy for a change. In 87, he got his chance, playing the principal in the underrated high school comedy, 3 O'Clock High.
There, gentlemen.
There isn't going to be any fight today! Now break it up, people. Go on home. Go on.
I said move, gentlemen. Jerry, I'm taking you home. Buddy, I want you to go to my office and wait for me there.
Sorry, Mr. O'Rourke, I just can't do that.
Really? Why don't I give you a little help?
There. Now it's your turn.
In 1990, John would play a completely different teacher.
Come on! Come on! You come on! Come on!
Class of 99 is the gonzo sequel to Class of 84, going a completely different route than the original movie. John, along with Patrick Kilpatrick and Pam Grier, plays military-grade robotic teachers who are assigned to reduce violence in a crime-ridden high school. John goes all out with his character, and he seems to be having fun with the material he's given.
Drug dealing is a capital offense.
Class of 99 is sometimes silly, but in a good way, and has more balls and firepower than most modern action movies. It's a fun cyberpunk B-movie sequel with outlandish scenes of carnage, gunfire, and robot prosthetics.
Attempted to infiltrate into San Carlos and was brutally murdered by Ramon Cota.
I have no commando unit under my command, nor am I aware of the existence of any such force.
General!
Delta Force 2 was the last film John did as an actor for Canon. Unfortunately, it's a subpar sequel, bogged down by a weak script and bad acting, although some of the action set pieces are well done. John plays General Taylor, who teams up with Chuck Norris to take down a ruthless South American drug lord, played by the creepy Billy Drago. Norris was reportedly not happy with the final film, and he seems pretty checked out during the entire movie.
We're coming in!
During shooting in the Philippines, one of the helicopters crashed into a ravine, killing 5 crew members from the production. John was also involved in the accident, but luckily he survived the crash, only suffering minor injuries.
Hi, my name's Violet. We heard you working in here, and I was just wondering if you'd like a cup of coffee.
An open invitation like Violet comes once in a lifetime.
In 1996, John had a small but memorable part in the sexy crime thriller Bound, the film debut of the Wachowskis, who 3 years later directed the first Matrix.
Chili, I'm gonna ask you 10 times. You understand?
He plays the brutal mob boss, Mickey, who has a soft spot for Violet, played by Jennifer Tilly. In the commentary track for the movie, the filmmakers share a brief but funny anecdote about John.
J.P. Ryan.
Great actor.
He's really good. Great.
Yeah, he came in and blew us away.
Yeah, he did his little audition. He was just like, he didn't do any lines, he just sort of did this little like riff on the character looking at us, and he was just
really intense.
He scared me.
Sure you're going to be okay? I mean, if you're having second thoughts, my offer still stands.
Thanks, Mickey, but I have to get out. You know, I have to get away from all this. But thanks. Thanks for everything.
Bound proved to be his last film role before he retired from acting in 1996. He lived a quiet life outside of show business, doing counseling and spiritual healing. In 2007, he suffered a fatal stroke and died. He was 70 years old. He left a remarkable legacy of interesting characters, and although he might be gone, he lives forever in the movies he left behind.